Well, first to what could be a game changer in Yemen's civil war. A few hours ago, the leader of the Houthi rebels announced that he's ready for a ceasefire if the Saudi-led coalition also wants peace. The Iranian-backed Houthis run much of western Yemen. You can have a look at the map we were going to pull up now. You can see there in red, that's the area the rebels control. It includes the key port city of Hodeidah, which the coalition has been trying to capture. Sam Kiley tells us about the rebels' latest move and why the timing matters.
Just under 3 weeks ago, the United States and the United Kingdom joined voices with the United Nations to call or renew their calls and demands for a ceasefire within 30 days in the Yemen. There has been a dialing down in the violence, and just in the last few hours, there has been a statement published by the leader of the Iranian-backed Houthi rebels who are clinging on to the port city of Hodeidah and control some 25 to 30% of the country more generally. That statement said in part that they are prepared, this is the Houthi rebels, to end their drone attacks and their use of long-range missiles as a sign of goodwill. There was an offer of goodwill that came from the Saudi-led coalition side, which about a week ago agreed to allow the medical evacuation of about 50 wounded Houthi rebels as a precondition to meeting. There are meetings hoped for to be held sometime over the next couple of weeks somewhere in Sweden. But this is a major breakthrough in a conflict that really has run into the sand for the Saudi-led coalition, which is trying to battle the Houthi rebels, and above all, to try to make sure that Iran does not get a foothold in that strategically important part of the Arabian Gulf that controls access to the Red Sea. At the same time, of course, the Iranians are insisting that they're backing their Shia brethren, the Houthis, in their efforts to prevent an annihilation, if you like, of the Houthi rebellion. But this, after many, many years of bloodshed, some tens of thousands of people injured, thousands wounded, and 400,000 children, according to the United Nations Children's Fund, on the verge of starvation, offers a slim glimmer of help, just of hope, just as the United Kingdom was expected to sponsor a demand at the UN Security Council, a demand for a resolution calling for a ceasefire and putting pressure particularly on the Saudis for that. And that would come on the eve of the publication expected from the United States on what the United States government believes happened to Jamal Khashoggi, the Washington Post correspondent who was murdered inside the consulate of the Saudi Kingdom in Istanbul. Those two issues have been tightly connected now for many weeks, because it is seen, really, that the murder of Jamal Khashoggi, which is now accepted as a premeditated killing by the Saudis, was effectively the straw that has broken the camel's back in terms of particularly congressional support for the very, very bloody and humanitarianly disastrous campaign that has unfolded over the last few years in the Yemen. Sam Kiley, CNN, Abu Dhabi.
Well, let's talk about the timing of all of this with Yemen expert Alana Deloja. She is a research fellow with the Washington Institute for Near East Policy. Good to have you with us.
Thank you.
The rebels say they're going to stop the missile and drone strikes if the Saudi-led coalition agree to it. How is Saudi Arabia likely to respond?
Well, I think the Saudis have been under pressure from the U.S. and the U.K. to respond quite positively. I think that they're going to follow the lead of the Hadi government. They, from the very beginning, they've always said that they're in the war because of the Hadi government and at the behest of the Hadi government. And so I think the Hadi government has suggested that they will follow suit. And I think everyone is looking to come to the table. So I'm hopeful that there will be a de-escalation, if not a complete ceasefire, at least a de-escalation.
It's interesting to note that on October 30th, The U.S. government's public position appeared to shift. We heard from both the Secretary of State, Mike Pompeo, and also the Defense Secretary, James Mattis, separately, but pretty much saying the same thing, that they called for the parties to cease hostility and for peace talks to begin in November. Those comments, of course, in the wake of the killing of the Washington Post journalist Jamal Khashoggi. Has the U.S. changed its position? Is its support for the Saudi-led coalition waning?
The U.S. position has been changing over the last, I would say, 2 months or so. I think that it kind of came to a head on October 30th, you're right, with those two comments. But there were private discussions going on in the background prior to those public comments, where the U.S. and the U.K. were really pressuring the coalition to try to find an end to this war, in part because the U.S. administration is receiving pressure from Congress. And with the U.S. elections, you know, at that time coming up, I think there was a sense of sort of time is running out. And so those private discussions had been happening, you know, before, but then it sort of came to a head on October 30th, in part because the UN Special Envoy has been looking to get talks together before the end of the year. And so it paired up quite nicely with his timeline as well.
Right. Let's talk about the human cost of this, because, I mean, the human cost of this war is staggering and it's heartbreaking. UNICEF say that about 80% of the population rely on humanitarian assistance daily. And we know that at least 10,000 people have died, but that's according to the United Nations. And that figure hasn't really been updated in quite a long time. And we're constantly seeing these pictures of children dying of starvation. But time and time again, talks aimed at peace have failed. What is it going to take to have a successful ceasefire?
Sure. I think on the humanitarian side, it's important to note that the reason for that is largely because commercial entities struggle to get basic goods into Yemen. The humanitarian folks are doing an awesome job. They just can't do everything. And in addition, the currency has devalued recently, which has created a much worse situation. So you're absolutely right that the situation in Yemen is pretty terrible. The UN is suggesting that there will be a famine by the end of the year that might be the worst famine in 100 years. So it's quite serious. In terms of what it will take, I think that the UN Special Envoy has made incredible progress over the last couple of months in terms of getting, you know, there's prisoner releases that are apparently lined up. He's done quite a bit to push for currency support. He's apparently sorted out the logistical problems that are the reasons the Houthis gave for not attending the talks last time. And so there's a series of things that have already happened prior to these talks, which really give, I think, a sense of hope that these talks might be the best talks since the Kuwait talks in 2016.
We can only hope so. Alana Deloja, really good to get your perspective. Thanks so much for your time tonight.